Okay, hello guys. Welcome to this discussion on this ICQ and IOSCE that I've been posting over the last 2 to 3 days. So we will go through question 1 to question 7. Okay, so question 1, I'll quickly discuss the question. So the question was a pedigree chart and it asked you, the given pedigree illustrates which type of inheritance. So if you remember, I'll just show you this. So you have an affected male who is not passing it down to anyone at all, whereas an affected female is passing it down to all her children. And now in this, the affected males again are not passing it on, but the affected females are passing it down to everyone. So this is a typical mitochondrial inheritance. So how do you identify mitochondrial inheritance? It is when the affected male does not pass it down to his offsprings, whereas an affected female will pass it down to all the offsprings typically, all right? And you also know why, because mitochondrial inheritance is through the mother, okay? It's a maternal inheritance, all right? So this classical pedigree is that of a mitochondrial inheritance, okay? So that was question one of this whole series. So you had to know your basics, okay? You had to know your basics in this, all right? Okay, so now it's an IOSCE. So that means based on your first question, there's something related to the first question that takes you forward to the second question. So let's see what was the second question. So second question was again about knowing your basics. Which of the following is or are mitochondrial disorders? So I've given you 4 options where possibly multiple options were right. So option A, LHON, that is Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy. All of you know that it is mitochondrial inheritance. Okay, that I've always told you, remember the 3 M's for LON, that is, it is mitochondrial mutation and therefore mitochondrial inheritance. And mitochondrial inheritance means it is maternal inheritance and usually the males are affected. So 3 M's. So it was very easy for you to crack option A. But what about option B, C and D? Option B was CPEO. Okay, that is chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia, again mitochondrially inherited disease. C was NARP, that is neuropathy, peripheral neuropathy, ataxia A, RP is retinitis pigmentosa. Again, yes, it has mitochondrial mutations and mitochondrial, therefore mitochondrial inheritance too. Option D, Best disease, a very, very important EPG question, so many times asked since my days. I don't know why they're so fond of it. Best disease, I always told you, it's best in terms of its fundus appearance, and best is bad, meaning B and AD, autosomal dominant inheritance. Okay, so it was, the answer was A, B and C. Okay, so A, B and C have mitochondrial inheritance. Now apart from this, are there any other diseases that have mitochondrial inheritance? I mean, I'm concerned with ophthalmological manifestations, diseases with ophthalmological manifestations. So when you have CPO, does it ring a bell? CPO is part of Kearns-Sayre syndrome. So Kearns-Sayre syndrome has CPEO, it has retinitis pigmentosa and cardiac conduction defects. So we know 3 diseases with mitochondrial four diseases with mitochondrial inheritance in ophthalmology, that is with eye manifestations. So number 1 is your LON. Number 2, remember CPEO part of your Kearns-Sayre syndrome. So the 3rd is there, another syndrome with RP, that is NARP syndrome. So these are the 4 things with mitochondrial inheritance. And best disease, as always I have told you, it's autosomal dominant inheritance, all right? And what is the other name for best disease? Vitelliform macular dystrophy, VMD, and it is due to mutation of VMD gene, also called as bestrophin gene. Okay, it's an ion channel. Okay, it's a chloride channel, it's a calcium sensitive chloride ion channel. Which one? This VMD protein, gene protein, or bestrophin. All right, so you've learned a little bit about BEST also. So now we'll move on to question 3 of the series of this integrated clinical question. So again, it is testing your basics, this 3rd question, where I'd given you a small pedigree chart and asked you which of the following explains the pedigree of LON. Okay, so this is what I had given. So in this particular one, what is this half and half denote, this half and half denotes a carrier state. So the female is a carrier and her children, some of her, a few of her children have got it. But to you, it looks like 50% of them have got it. So you think it is autosomal dominant. See, but if it is autosomal dominant, the mother will not be a carrier, but she will be manifesting the disease. Okay, she would have manifested the disease. So what explains the whole thing? This is explained by heteroplasmy. Now, what is this heteroplasmy? So options I had given was lionization, homology, homoplasmy and heteroplasmy. Now, lionization, as all of you know, it is a random inactivation of one of the X chromosomes. See, I as a female will have two X chromosomes, or for that matter, any female, right? Whereas a male will have only one X chromosome. So what can happen is when I have two X chromosomes, so whatever genes are present in the X chromosome, I will have a double dose of it. Whereas the male counterpart will have only single. Yes, so I will become a super female, right? So to counter that, nature has made it in such a way that one X chromosome is randomly inactivated, so that I also carry only one set of genes from my X chromosome, and any other male, like my brother also carries only one of that excess. So nature has devised a way that we are balanced. Okay, so that is exactly why, if you remember, if you look back now in your triple X, yes, your 43XXY, there will be XY and an extra X. So they actually have a double, an extra set of genes and which are present on the X chromosome. So that is why they have these odd characteristics. All right, you get it? So it's really beautiful. Okay, so that is lionization. So this is not due to lionization. Homology, I'll talk about it in another MCQ. All right, now what is this homoplasmy? Homoplasmy and heteroplasmy, the concept is with respect to mitochondrial DNA. See, mitochondrial DNA, there are millions of copies in every cell, in every eukaryotic cell. So now I can have a uniform set of mitochondrial DNA or a mixture of normal and abnormal, that is mutated mitochondrial DNA. So when I have a uniform set, so this uniform set can be either normal uniform set or an abnormal uniform set. That means I can have the entire mitochondria all having normal mitochondrial genes, or completely everything abnormal mitochondrial genes. That is called homoplasmy. Homo means same. Now, heteroplasmy is a mixture of normal mitochondrial DNA and mutated mitochondrial DNA. Alright. Now, why is this important? So, when you have a combination, it's called heteroplasmy. So, in a heteroplasmic state, the person can either be normal or can manifest a disease depending on which DNA is more. If his normal DNA content is more, he will not manifest the disease. Whereas if his abnormal mitochondrial content is more, DNA's content is more, he's going to manifest the disease. Yes? So this is called penetrance. Penetrance is the disease actually manifesting. All right? And also, heteroplasmy determines your expressivity, the expressivity of the disease. That means how severe is my disease? Do you understand? So I may have the disease, but I may not be really affected by the disease, or I may be affected by the disease quite early in its natural history. So all this is determined by this phenomenon called heteroplasmy. All right, now let's say I have homoplasmy of this all abnormal mitochondrial DNA. Of course I will manifest the disease. Do you understand? So here, because the mother was a carrier, that means she was a she had heteroplasmy herself. All right, and she also passed it down to have offsprings in different ratios. So it looked to you as if it is autosomal dominant, whereas no, it's because of the heteroplasmy, the penetrance is different. It's like a 50% penetrance. I hope you've understood this pedigree chart. Okay, so I have put up the flashcards so you can go through the questions again. So I think that was the third question. All right, so now coming to question number four. So question number four, we are continuing it. So now I have told you that I'm going to talk about LHON, okay, LHON. So LHON is due to point mutations in the mitochondrial DNA involving genes encoding certain components of your electron transport chain, that is your respiratory chain. Now, which of the following options denote the component that is affected? See, now it looks to you as if this is a clinical question because I'm talking about lawn. Whereas your image is completely a biochemistry image, which shows you complex 1, complex 2, 3 and 4, which are present in the inner membrane of the mitochondrial cell membrane. All right, on its bilayer, it's present in the inner layer. So I have marked A, B, C and D, and my question is, what is component, which component is affected in lawn? So for this, you need to know biochemistry, okay? And you need to know what exactly happens in lawn. So you need to know a little bit more in lawn. So lawn, you know, is mitochondrial disease. Where is the mutation? I've told that in the question. In the question, I've told you it is a point mutation. Okay, it's a point mutation. Now, what kind of point mutation is it? Is it a null mutation or is it a missense mutation? It is a missense mutation involving what? One of the complexes of this ETC, electron transport chain. Which complex? A, B, C or D? It is A. Alright? It is A. A complex. Complex 1, which I have named it as A. So it is complex 1. There is a problem. Okay? Subunits of complex 1. Have you understood this? So what are these mutations? So before I go on to question number 5, let me discuss about these mutations. So these mutations, like I just told you, these are missense mutations. What are missense mutations? One nucleotide is being replaced by another nucleotide. Yes, basic, we've all learnt in school. Yes. So now we have three mutations. Okay, three classical mutations in lawn. So I'll tell you what it is. Now before that, what is this A? What is this A? Yes, this A component, okay, this is complex 1. Okay, this is complex 1, which I think I've asked in question 5 what exactly it is. But I'll tell you now so that it's easy to learn the genes. So this A represents complex 1. And what is the name of complex 1? It is an enzyme. That enzyme is called NADH dehydrogenase. What is it called? NADH dehydrogenase. So you have N and you have D. ND, right? And how do we call a mitochondrial DNA? MT DNA. Small m, small t DNA, right? So the genes are MT hyphen ND. MT ND genes. Now which genes? We have 1, 4, 6, 3 genes. MT ND 1, that is mitochondrial NADH dehydrogenase 1. Mitochondrial, obviously DNA. NADH dehydrogenase 4, that is MTND4, and then we have MTND6. So what numbers? 1, 4, 6. So these are the three genes. All right. Now, why and what it's important for? Now, ND1 has the worst prognosis. When you have mutation in ND1, it has the worst prognosis. Now, what's the next one? ND4, MTND4. That gene mutation is the most common gene mutation. Okay, second MCQ, because life is all about MCQs. MTND6. MTND6 has the best prognosis. Got it? So 1, 4, 6, 1 worst prognosis, 4 most common, and 6 best prognosis. Best prognosis in the sense visual prognosis. Got it? Okay. Now I'm going to show off a little bit of my memory, which maybe it can be asked for you. Now this most common, what is this most common? See, G1177-8A. Okay, G1177-8A. Okay, so what is this? G is your G from your, what is that called? Your nucleotide, okay, and at the position of 1177-8, that is where this missense mutation is happening. Okay, so 11 point locus 1177-8 is the most common because that is that MTND4. Is that clear? Now, what is the best prognosis? I told you MTND6, the 6 wala number. So that is 14484. What is that number? 14484. The first one was 1177-8. Next is 14484. You all know section 144. Yes. 144. Yes, we don't like it, but that's the best prognosis. So 144-84. All right. 144-84 has that place when you have a mutation, missense mutation, it has got the best prognosis. Whereas, which is the most common site for mutation? It is 11778, that is MTND4, most common mutation. Is that clear? So have we learned? So there are three genes, MTND146. And what is this complex one? Complex one is NADH dehydrogenase. Okay. Now, is there any other name for this enzyme? Yes. See, dehydrogenase. Can I say oxidoreductase? Yes, so there's another name for that. It's called oxidoreductase. Okay, NADH oxidoreductase, or you can also call it as ubiquinone oxidoreductase. Ubiquinone oxidoreductase. Is that clear? Ubiquinone dehydrogenase. So these are the various names for this complex one. All right, is that clear to everyone? Okay, so now we go to question number 5. Oh my god, where I can't find question number 5. Where is question number 5? Is question number 5. Wait guys. Question number 5. Oh, what does A represent? So A represents, as you know, NADH dehydrogenase. I've already told you. Okay, so that was from question number 4. So that was so I had given you different options. So it is NADH dehydrogenase. And what is the other name for NADH dehydrogenase? I told you it is ubiquinone oxidoreductase. Okay. Now the next thing is, you should know what is the name for complex 2, 3 and 4. Complex 2 is called succinate dehydrogenase. Complex 2 is called succinate dehydrogenase. Quinol succinate dehydrogenase. That's the entire name. Now what about 3 and 4? It's easy. 3 and 4 have the word cytochrome C. Okay. Cytochrome C. Now what is this third one? Third one is cytochrome C reductase. And 4 is cytochrome C oxidase. Now how to remember this? All of you love to drink, prefer to drink RO water. RO. R comes first. O next. So NADH dehydrogenase, also called as ubiquinone dehydrogenase or ubiquinone oxidoreductase or coenzyme Q oxidoreductase, because the other name for ubiquinone is coenzyme Q. Second one, succinate dehydrogenase, the entire name quinol succinate dehydrogenase. Number 3, cytochrome C R, so reductase, cytochrome C O R O, so oxidase. Okay, so complex 1, complex 2, complex 3, complex 4. So we also learned a little bit of biochemistry. All right, so that is what was the whole objective of giving out these ICQs, integrated clinical questions. Okay, integrating it with the basics, because next is coming, and next has your basics integrated into clinics, and there's no better way to teach you basics than integrating it with clinics, and no better person to teach you basics than a clinician. That is what I believe in. Okay, so now we will talk about question number 6, which actually finally came to lawn. Ma'am, kab aap lawn ke bare mein baat karoge? That was one serious question from people. Ma'am, lawn, we all know you're going to talk about lawn. When are you actually launching lawn? Okay, lawn. So question number 6, so now it was know your clinics, because we're done with the basics. Below is the fundus image of a 29-year-old male with history of smoking and alcohol, who presented with a painless decrease in vision over the past 3 months. Right eye visual loss followed by left eye over 2 months. His pupillary reaction to light is normal. Which of the following statements is true? See, you don't even have to look at the fundus to find out the answer, because everything is given in the clinical question. The answer is lawn. How? See, 29-year-old male with some history of smoking and alcohol, that means you have mitochondrial stress, there is oxidative stress. Okay. And he has got this painless decrease in vision, where they've told you over the past 3 months, and one eye affected, right eye affected, and over the next 2 months, the left eye affected. So that is sequential. If you watched my MDA video on YouTube, you would know I have described what is sequential vision loss. Yes. Within 2 to 12 months of one eye being affected, if the other eye is affected, that is sequential. So I've given exactly that here. So one eye vision loss and the next eye after 2 months, and this age group 29 and a male, all this should make you think of lawn. Okay, all this should make you think of lawn. And pupillary reaction to light is normal. Okay, now lawn is an exception, because normally when you have an optic nerve problem, you know that you will have a afferent pupillary defect. The pupil will be sluggish. When it is unilateral, you will have RAPD. When you have bilateral, you will have APD, afferent pupillary defect. But they're saying it's normal. Now, why is this normal? So this is so beautiful. This has to do with anatomy and physiology of my ganglion cells. See, in the ganglion cells, recently we have discovered what is called as melanopsin sensitive retinal ganglion cells. Okay, melanopsin and photosensitive. So that means this melanopsin sensitive cells react to light. Yes, they have nothing to do with vision. Okay, is that clear? So now, although my vision is lost, these ganglion cells, these melanopsin ganglion cells, are relatively spread in lawn, in LHON. They're relatively spread. That is the reason why the pupillary reflex is normal. Is that clear? See, so many of you have asked me this doubt over so many years, and I've been responding to that in individual chat. So this is the first time I think I'm going on air and actually giving out the answer. Okay, so it's because of these set of ganglion cells, they're relatively spared, and that is why the pupillary light reflex is maintained as normal. Is that clear? Wonderful. No, you learn something new. I know it's always my eureka moment, but I already had this eureka moment a couple of years ago. So now we know that this is lawn. Now when you look at the fundus image, you will realize that the disc is a little hyperemic and the vessels are all tortuous like disc edema. But the thing is, when you do an FFA in lawn, it will not leak. The dye will not leak out of the vessel, unlike in usual cases of papilledema and unlike in usual cases of optic neuritis, where on the disc the dye will leak and the disc will get stained. This will not happen in lawn. Okay, so that means option B is false, where I've given FFA would show leakage of dye at the optic nerve head. No way. Now OCT would reveal peripapillary RNFL thinning. That is in very late stage, when you have actually an optic atrophy. Not when in this patient. In this patient, the optic disc is hyperemic and the optic disc is swollen. So the peripapillary RNFL will show swelling. Okay, it will show swelling. There will be an increase in thickness of the RNFL and the overall OCT. Now option C, patient should be advised to quit smoking and alcohol, because of this smoking and alcohol, his mitochondrial system is into stress. There is an oxidative stress and reactive oxygen species, ROS, is being released. Because you know that ETC, electron transport chain, or your respiratory chain, is the endogenous source of ROS. Now there is some problem here, and there's going to be an extraordinarily high amount of ROS, and smoking and alcohol increases it in everyone, and in these people it's just going to blow it out of proportion. Okay, and the visual loss will be accelerated, so they have to quit, not even decrease, they have to quit. Okay, so that is true. Genetic testing is not useful to assess his visual prognosis. No, I just told you, when you know that it is ND1, MT-ND1 mutation, it's got the worst prognosis. Okay, and when it is this 144/84, it's got the best prognosis. So genetic testing is very, very useful in counseling your patient, although it is not going to change your management. But yes, you can tell the patient to how early his vision loss can occur and how fast it can progress. So option D is false. Genetic testing is very useful. Okay, got it? Did you like this question? I love framing this question. Okay, now the last question. Okay, so before that, let's just little revise lawn. So lawn affects usually males. Just remember, mummies are fond of their sons. Okay, so usually it affects males, again because of the heteroplasmy, and it affects males in the second and third decades. Okay, young males, and sequential bilateral involvement, okay, resulting in a acute or subacute painless bilateral decrease in vision sequentially, and eventually it lead to primary optic atrophy. Now, when you see the OCT, there will be a peripapillary around the optic disc. The RNFL will show swelling. And if you do an FFA, fundus fluorescein angiography, dye will not leak out the vessels. That is why the disc edema of Lawn is called as pseudo edema. Okay, that's why it's called pseudo edema. Okay, now coming to the visual field defect, what do you get in whenever there's an optic nerve involvement? We either get a central scotoma, central cecal scotoma, typically. Okay, so same thing here. Now, what are the reasons for Lawn? There are three factors. One, you know, is this defective post correlation. So you have an increased ROS. So this is called an Oxfos disease. Which is an Oxfos disease? OXPHOS, oxidative phosphorylation disease. Lawn is an oxidative phosphorylation disease. The term is OXPHOS. I've given it all in the flashcard for you. And they also say in Lawn, there is an abnormality in the glutamate transport in the ganglion cells. Yes, so that is also the reason why the other cells are spared, like photoreceptors are spared, although they have a lot of mitochondria, they have a lot of energy requirement, still they are spared because RGCs, the retinal ganglion cells, are the ones which have a lot of mitochondria, as well as they have this glutamate transportation involved. So there's an abnormal glutamate transport which eventually results in death of this ganglion cells. Okay, so these are the stuff that you need to know about LHON. Okay, now we'll go to the last question. Last question was combining a little bit of pharmacology. So again, know your basics, know your clinics. You need to know your basics about pharmacology and clinics about Lawn. So patient who is a carrier for Lawn develops an infection which needs antibiotics for treatment. Which of the following should be avoided in this patient? So first of all, why this concept of antibiotics being avoided? That is basically to do with what is called as your endosymbiotic theory. Now, what is this endosymbiotic theory? Very theoretical, no? Yeah. See, we all developed from prokaryotes. Yes, we are eukaryotes. We all developed from prokaryotes. So in that sense, we had something to do with bacteria and we developed from them. So this mitochondria is said to be something that we derive from bacteria. So that means we share something common with bacteria. Yes, what we share in common? Some mitochondrial genes are homologous. So the genes share a homology with bacterial genome. Yes, so now when I have antibiotics which are going to act on DNA, there is a possibility that these will DNA or RNA, okay, something to do with the nucleic acids, okay. So these antibiotics have a likelihood that they can affect the mitochondrial DNA as well. Okay, now let me ask you a question. Aminoglycosides, all of you know, it acts on 30S component, and linezolid, if I'm not wrong, it acts on 50S. And chloramphenicol also acts on 30S, if I'm not wrong, 30S unit. Yes. So these subunits have a homology. They resemble. Something they have in common with mitochondrial DNA. So when these antibiotics act against the bacteria, the side effect is just like shadi ki side effects. You have side effects which will manifest on the mitochondrial DNA. Now, already in my Lawn patient, he's a carrier that I'm talking about. You have some mitochondrial mutation and my ETC, something is wrong. So when these antimicrobials are given, all the three, chloramphenicol, amikacin, linezolid. In fact, I'll give you a big list. So all of them have a potential to further accelerate the disease process, so the vision loss is accelerated and the vision loss would be of a greater magnitude. So that is the reason why these drugs should be avoided in Lawn patients. So what are the drugs to be avoided? So let's remember it as e-talc. Okay, you all know the Z talcum powder. So I'm going to take off the Z part, Z, and take only the EE and the talc. EE, erythromycin, ethambutol. Erythromycin, ethambutol. T, talc. A, aminoglycoside. So amikacin, everything comes under that. Aminoglycoside. L, linezolid. C, chloramphenicol. So all these drugs should be avoided in a lawn patient. Is that clear? So that means even as an intern or as a general practitioner or a GP or a medicine intern or a surgery intern or a medicine PG, surgery PG, you're giving prescribing antibiotics to a young male. Don't you just casually want to ask the vision of the patient, is his vision good? Ask him to close one eye and check the vision of each eye separately, because when you have only one eye vision loss and the other eye is normal, patient will not really complain. Okay, so you never know, you might be picking up lawn. Maybe it is underdiagnosed in the community, we never know. Okay, so what are the drugs that you will avoid? E-talc, which is erythromycin, ethambutol, tetracycline, aminoglycosides, linezolid and chloramphenicol. Is that clear? So that brings me to the end of this IOSCE. Yes, ophthalosky. You know what is OSCE? Objective Structured Clinical Examination. Okay, so and it also brings us to an end to this first series of ICQs. I hope you enjoyed the questions and the discussion as much as I did. So I will put out all the flashcards for you and you can use it. So all the best guys. So tomorrow we will start another series. All right, bye.